Hey guys, thank you so much for tuning in to Classic Album Sundays with our very, very special series called My Classic Album. I'm Tina Edwards and I'm really, really pumped to talk to our guests today. With My Classic Album, it's either that we talk to an artist about a classic album that feels special to them, or in this case, we talk to them about a record which is their very own classic album. I just want to say a quick thank you as well to Arts Council England for helping us to make this happen. So without much more further ado, these guys are celebrating 15 years since the release of their debut album, Inside In, Inside Out. It is Luke Prichard and Hugh Harris of the Kooks. How's it going?
Hello. Thanks for having us, Tina.
It's an absolute pleasure. Luke, it looks like you've got a really lovely drink that I just saw just before we started recording. Oh,
yeah. Yeah, I've kind of taken to, the cosmopolitan in a can affair. Yes. It's quite good. Well, I'm celebrating 15 years with Hugh, so I thought...
Exactly.
Hey,
cheers.
I have a cocktail. But it's quite good, actually. I recommend it in a can.
It looks delicious. And it's the only way to be cosmopolitan right now as well.
Indeed, you're correct. On trend.
Oh, Matt, well, I cheers you with my apple squash, which is a bit less rock and roll, but hey ho. Hugh, have you got yourself a bevy?
I feel really left out right now, but having said that, it's 4:05 in the afternoon, guys. Like, I don't even think the Arches is finished yet.
it's 6 p.m. somewhere, dude.
Very true. Very true. That's what we'll roll with. Can you guys believe it's been 15 years? Does it feel like it's been that long or has it flown?
Do you want to answer that, Hugh?
15 years. It feels like at times like it hasn't gone very quickly. Like it feels like we've sort of lived a 15-year career. It seems like we've been through everything that you'd expect someone in a band for 40 years would go through within such a small space. I think we had to do a lot of growing quite quickly. Like early on, we had a lot of like crazy stuff happen. So definitely at times has felt slow, but then of course, like, man, it's been super fun. And to be celebrating this benchmark is just, it's an honor. It's like it's humbling, actually.
Amazing. Yeah, and how about feeling? Does it kind of, it feels like a time?
Yeah, it does. I mean, I agree with you. I mean, we've had so many kind of eras of the band as well. So it's kind of feels like lots of chapters, but equally we were so young. You know, we were so young. Like, you know, when we started out, especially like Hugh was 16, I was like 18. So when you start out so young, I guess it's like half our lives basically is being in the Kooks. So I mean, that's kind of wild, but like same as you, you know, I just think we're feeling like overwhelming kind of gratitude, because like, you know, our fans and stuff have been amazing and we just can't believe like the record is sort of evergreen, you know. And it's nice to take a minute to think about it and try and remember some of the memories we forgot.
That's it. So I imagine sort of life moved pretty damn fast at that time. So it must be really cool to kind of have a period of time to reflect on it. I wanted to kind of just take you guys watching at home through a kind of little bit of extra context about the record. There might be some of you that are coming to this album for the first time, or some of you who are really excited to revisit it in detail with us already. Just give you a little bit of background, really. So the Kooks exploded onto the British music scene in 2006. And their cocktail of 60s rock, post-punk, Britpop and earworm melodies came to distinguish them from the crowd. Themes of infatuation, love and lust were at the forefront of Inside In, Inside Out. And tracks like Naive, She Moves in Her Own Way and You Don't Love Me were anthems for a coming-of-age fan base. They took the time to discover their direction whilst touring with The Thrills before, and I've been preparing this. They recorded their debut as The Kooks at the kink studio called Conk. Got it out. The Kooks worked with prestigious producer Tony Hoffer, who at the time had just been producing albums with Belle and Sebastian and Beck, amongst lots of other brilliant names. Inside In, Inside Out was a huge success. It hit quadruple platinum status in the UK within a year. And it was a record that, alongside the likes of Arctic Monkeys and Razorlight, created a transatlantic conversation with the wave of indie rock coming out of the States. And so here we are with Inside In, Inside Out, celebrating 15 years since the release. So a little bit of context just to kind of kick us off. There's something that I wanted to run past both of you, which is that I heard that you guys got signed after just a few months after forming, which sounds like a dream scenario. So I wonder if you could just verify, is that true?
It was too early. We should have waited. Where it all went wrong. No, it was really quick, wasn't it? It was, about 6 months from forming, we had a record deal. Yeah. I mean, it was quick, though. I mean, I think, you know, at the time as well, it was the time of bands, you know, you got to remember that it was like, it was a different kind of landscape. And yeah, it was very quick, very quick.
And how did it happen? Was it kind of sending off a demo? Did you get scouted by an A&R? What happened?
It was really through our managers, Starwood Management. We were in a pub and the landlord just asked us if we were in a band, and we just formed a band. So we said, yeah, here's our demo. We like Lou Reed and The Clash. I mean, it was that simple a conversation. And then about 3 days later, I was in school in a class, and I see this call. And I was just, I think I must have known he was about to call. But I basically just like was like, see you later, I'm out of here. I went out and had a conversation with Mark, who ended up being our manager. It was like, I love your band, can I meet? And that was it. So it was like, you know, they really instantly got it and took us to see publishers and labels.
Wow.
So just one demo that we'd done that, you know, a manager heard, and then it was, yeah, that was the route.
That's amazing.
That was a good time for bands. A lot of bands were being picked up by labels because you had like the Libertines and the Strokes who were kind of starting to make a presence. And so we got signed, but lots and lots of bands were getting signed at that. It was a really great time for bands. I mean, that's changed now, exactly. But then it was like, we took a lot of people with us, even from Brighton. I mean, a lot of our friends got signed. With us, we really, like the four of us, we were nutty and messy, but we were focused and respectful of like the work started like when we got signed. The hard work started then, and
yeah,
I think that's what we really had somehow on our side, was a lot of that drive and respect for the art in the music, and that was really like, yeah, that was really it, that really found a home, I think, in the country and the world.
Yeah,
we found it was a great label at the time, you know, as well, Virgin. And Philippe Escali was like the you know, he was a bit of a hero because he'd started Source Records, and you know, it was just so slick. And we were very, you know, we got an amazing team very quickly. But like you said, we signed our record deal and we did a year of touring before we made our album, which is again something that I think really benefited us. You know, we weren't chucked in. Yes, we signed early. Yes, we did a deal, but we didn't have the super pressure, and we didn't do a huge deal. It wasn't like a lot of money and stuff like that. So it was, it kind of was quite a nice, it was nicely, it worked out nicely, basically. Awesome. Gave us time to get our record together. Yeah.
What do you think were that the main factors that helped you guys to develop your sound? I mean, it sounds like the experience, you know, created a really ripe sort of situation for you guys to find yourselves sort of musically at that stage. But I wondered if there's anything in particular in that year. You know, I've heard rumors that you guys brought loads of songs into the studios of, you know, just to try things out of what worked and what didn't. And yeah, I guess I'm sort of curious as to how you found your distinctive sound on the road before you got to
the bounce. It was all about the bounce with the Kooks. Slightly dancey, you know. I don't know. It was just like, we were out every night at bars with bands playing. I think, you know, it was all about the live thing, you know, and we, yeah, it was quite chaotic. But we had four, I mean, the four of us had such different musical influences that it was, I mean, the band is kind of why that formula of the band didn't last, I think, because we were pulling in such different directions. But that first album, it's what kind of makes it what it is, which is a real fusion record. I mean, it's like, you know, the bass player is playing on a different track to the drummer, and the, you know, me and Hugh are like doing something over there. It felt like that, didn't it? It was weird. There was a lot of different fusions, and it was chaos, really, like trying to bottle chaos.
I was going to ask you what the creative challenges were in making the album, because I imagine, you know, you've just had this incredible experience on the road, finding your style, you know, the way you just described you guys using these sort of different tracks. Like, were there any other creative challenges that sort of made you as strong as you were and made such a strong record?
The hardest thing was like the B&B we stayed at. There was like quite a few like quite heavy fellas. So like in the morning we'd kind of be, you know, leaving in our like tight jeans. You'd be like running the gauntlet to try and get to the studio. That was probably the hardest bit.
I mean, it was the whole thing was a creative challenge. When you put yourself in, like as a teenager, as a young person, putting yourself in like on the line, your heart on the line, your soul, or your like stepping out and being creative is a creative challenge. It's the biggest challenge of all. I mean, it's terrifying for someone of that age to kind of be exposing themselves in that way. And then if you have like internal kind of questionable functionality of these four people as well, it's like, yeah, trying to capture that by recording an album together and capturing the live thing was a huge creative challenge. Mm. And then like the way we dressed was like genuinely a challenge to our own personal safety at times.
Like you kind of forget that though. I was talking to someone about this the other day, and it was just like walking around Brighton. It was dangerous, wasn't it? I mean, I hope things have changed. But,
Brighton has a lot of answer for that, I think, because you know you even go there today and it's like in the most beautiful way, gorgeous and liberal and lovely but the problem with us is that we kind of took Brighton on tour, and I don't think like parts of the UK really necessarily were ready for Brighton, and like we just had a tough time, but and it kind of hardened us. I felt like we were a little bit, after the year of touring, kind of battle hardened. We kind of came out guns blazing, a bit of criticism from the press. So that kind of got our backs up. And so we had a bit to prove. Not in like a cheeky way, but I think we were just passionate.
That was the thing then, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was all a bit. Yeah.
I guess there's something about. What you said really rung true with me, because I also, you know, as someone that would, I grew up in the Isle of Wight, where there's, you know, a very strong sense of subcultures. You got the emos, you got the goths, you got the chavs. I was very much, you know, the mulleted, lip-ringed emo who was like, oh, I don't feel safe for the way I'm dressed. I don't feel safe for portraying, you know, what my interests are. So it's really interesting that you guys sort of had that experience in, you know, figuring out who you were, because you had to figure out your musical big tastes time. And styles so publicly. So that's tough.
Our personalities, we were growing people. We weren't fully formed men yet. We were just, so there's a duality there, and that's just a reflection in the record massively. And I think that's why young people still kind of gravitate towards it. That's why it's still alive, and why it's such a kind of a rite of passage in musical growth in teenagers. It speaks volumes.
I think like when I've gone back and listened to the album a bit, you know, I think it is quite emo. Actually, I like on reflection, it's funny how you know with a bit of time when you really analyze it.
Yeah, that song "Tell Them From Me" is literally "Tell Them From Me" is this tune, which is actually you can find on our vinyl release, which will be repackaged this coming year.
Hey,
that's one of the tracks,
greatest hits
on the It's the
Hugh first. Wanted to name the album Coldplay because he thought it would just sell loads of albums.
The greatest hits. Yeah. Cold Fingers Face Play by the Kooks. But
Cha-ching.
So we're gonna repackage Inside In, Inside Out brackets Coldplay by the Kooks. And sell. And
you don't need that tag.
Have this album, which literally has, like, I mean, I used to play in a bit of an emo-y metal band before we kind of formed the Kooks. So this song definitely has some of that in it.
It's a direct thing.
And emo is just like, what is it? An abbreviation for emotional music. Mm-hmm. That's just all music.
Totally.
Absolutely. And of course, I mean, you guys, you know, were, I think, between about 16 and 20. And, you know, like you said, Hugh, you guys were literally still growing up, like hormones would be akimbo. And so, you know, emo was huge at the time as well, as was indie, sort of this little mini revival of Britpop-ish bands, I guess, with like Maximo Park and Kaiser Chiefs and a little bit of that feel. So, yeah, I think it was a time where, I don't know, the songwriting feels very much on its sleeve. Not, you know, it's not hiding anything. I think, Luke, you're the main lyricist.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. I think that's fair to say. I mean, yeah.
I wondered if, you know, that comment you made about it feeling quite emo, I wonder if you could tell us more about that.
yeah, exactly. I mean, it's just, especially in the lyrics and in my, like, my vocal takes. It's a lot of teen, it's a lot of angst, and I always felt like that, but I don't know, there's something different about going back and, like, we play those songs, well, we used to play those songs before coronavirus every other night, but it's going back and listening to the record and analyzing it a little bit, I just thought, I think there's a lot of pain, you know, and it's like a lot of growing pains, and it's definitely just more evident to me, I think. I just think that I definitely was in quite an angsty place, and I think that's a thing that I never thought. I always thought it was more, I don't know, I would never put us in an emo kind of category, but it is, and it's kind of cool. I'm kind of really happy about that. It's an expression in a way, you know what I mean?
There's elements of the time sort of in there, because, you know, we reflect, music reflects culture, culture reflects music reflects the other music. You know, there's a whole relationship going on, I guess.
I think that it's like when you think of your own music as someone who makes it, like, obviously you think of your influences. And so because emo wouldn't be a natural influence for me, I wouldn't think of it. And we were, you know, it's like you talked about the conversation between, like, New York scene, London scene, you know, we were obsessed with, like, Strokes and really loved the Killers, and it was like this kind of conversational thing of, and what was that song? What was that band, Bandages? Do you remember that tune?
Bandages. Hot Heat.
Like, that was Hot Heat.
Yes.
Amazing band. Strong. Like, we were kind of, to me, it was a lot of that. I mean, of course, we love the classics, but there was that conversation. Definitely, I think that was a really cool way of putting it, where we got influenced by these new indie American bands, and then we kind of came back with a kind of more British version, obviously better, obviously. But then, like I say, I would think of those things, but then actually there's another dimension to that, to Inside In, Inside Out, which is kind of quite emo, and it's got a bit of that, quite a lot of that in it, and I just hadn't really thought about that.
But it's not, I would say, like, your writing on that record is so definitely heart on sleeve emotional, like the things that you'd speak about are, like, definitely angsty and angry, like there's fury and there's pain. But it's not like the thing that draws you in about it is that it's not kind of self-indulgent. It's got this, like, universal quality to it that you can essentially, like, relate to, which is positive and outward looking, and isn't kind of too dwelling within that space. It kind of, like, it, there's a catharsis in talking about that kind of stuff, but it's also, like, dressed up in this really positive sound, and that's so nice difference, I think, between that record and like an emo record.
We did talk a lot about that because we were like obsessed with the Smiths, and we were, I remember we talked a lot about having the kind of melancholic words with danceable music. That was definitely an influence, I think. But yeah,
big time.
Awesome. And you know, I think what I can hear on the record as well is a lack of fear for pop hooks, because I think a lot of a lot of music a few years before, and I'm thinking about rock from the 90s of like Blur and Oasis, you know, I think if I was to utter the word pop around Damon Albarn or something, you know, I don't know how well it would go down, but I feel like there is a sense of actual really memorable hooks on this record that are loud and proud, and it's, you know, it's not trying to be too cool. It's got that really genuine, sincere rock and roll sort of aesthetic and belief system down to the core, but it's got these really memorable poppy hooks sort of all the way through, and I think that's testament as to why I think there were six singles on this album, which is amazing. You know,
that's so cool.
Yeah it's thanks. Oh Matt, no worries. It's
like
just
that.
Something that stood out to me.
Yeah,
so what is it like for both of you when you listen back to it, because I know Luke, you've touched on this a bit, but I think there's a lot of artists who would shudder at the idea of listening back to their own record 15 years on. You know, I think it's kind of just a human condition that we find it hard to listen back to our voice, let alone an entire album that, you know, we might have made. Yeah. So do you look at it kind of objectively? Are there pangs of wishing you did anything different? Like, what's the experience overall for both of you?
I think because we do quite regularly do things differently live with the record, we're constantly reinventing it. I mean, I wouldn't say like we're changing it or replacing anything, but we are definitely adapting. Like, it's like geometry, the geometry of the song changes when you play it live. But so that kind of keeps it fresh for us. I've really enjoyed going back to it personally right now. At the time, listening to it was super not cool and like a bit too close. But it's really nice to reflect now, because I mean, I've been actually playing it every day, but on my guitar, because of lockdown and my fingers don't work anymore, and I need to get them working again because we're going to be playing soon. And I'm like, this is hard. It's really hard. It's like fast and it's difficult, and I need some help.
Don't worry, it'll be okay.
I can imagine the fingers need a little bit of re-oiling after not touring for a bit. So that makes perfect sense.
I wonder what it's going to be like with it.
Whose hand is this? It's not mine anymore. It's gone.
Yeah, I was going to say, I wonder what it's going to be like, you know, with everyone when we get back to festivals. Is everyone going to be like kind of really shit? Like the first festival's back, everyone's like, oh, God. I mean, anyone that uses a lot of backing tracks is fine, but if you like...
You have like a money back thing.
You know, exactly, sauce, you know. Listen, we haven't played for 2 years.
Let us off. Let us off.
People get like kids up on stage all the time these days to play the songs with the band. Maybe we could just
that would be cool. Ourselves. I like that. Green Day would do that. It's so cool. We should definitely do that.
Yeah, and I think there's certain artists as well who I won't drop, but like there are some singers who have really gruffed up their vocal cords over the years, and you just see them kind of like handing the mic to the crowd, take the high part. Like, yeah, I know.
Totally. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you guys about working with the producer, Tony Hoffer, because he's brilliant, and he's worked with amazing people at the time that you went to work with him as well, you know, putting together your first record. Was it intimidating? Was it exciting? Like, what was the whole experience?
Yeah, it was a little bit intimidating. Although Tony's like the loveliest man you ever meet. But also really sharp and funny, and you don't mess with Tony. He's got that kind of character. But yeah, I mean, he's like, you know, this sort of hotshot producer from LA, and like, you know, it was a little bit like that. Once we did like 2 days with him, he came to the rehearsal room in Brighton, and he like came to the pub with us and stuff, you know. And I was like, okay, it's cool. This guy, you know, he was like pretty down to earth. But yeah, his music, what, you know, he'd been in Beck's band, and you know, he'd worked with a lot of artists that we like were obsessed with. So it was quite an honor. But it was brilliant. I mean, he basically took something very raw, and I think he was very, what I loved with his production with us was he wasn't trying to polish it up too much, you know. He just wanted to add a bit of refinement, and he's a real like sound guy, you know. He's the kind of guy who's read all the kind of, you know, George Martin books and knows like how to mic everything perfectly. So a lot of the record was quite technical like that with him, and then just him just letting us do our thing. If that makes sense. So he was hands on, hands off, but yeah, just an incredible guy, unbelievable guy, to be honest.
Awesome. Yeah. It sounds like he created a really like safe space for you guys to speak
about. Yeah.
Hugh, what were you gonna add?
Yeah. I was just gonna say that I think he had the hardest job really out of everyone, because we had such a great live thing, and to capture that in the studio is difficult, especially if someone who is so genius as Tony Hoffer. Like, in a way, he does know how to make really incredible, polished, gorgeous sounding records. But for him to do that with us wouldn't have been right. So I think there would have been something quite magical that happened within him to kind of let the live thing in the band breathe and not kind of push us through a certain studio mill. And he really, really found that sweet spot of like recording a live band on a record. Like, I mean, it's just like the most like raucous sounding album. It doesn't sound like it. I don't know where, what it sounds like it was made. It just doesn't feel like it was made in the studio. It feels like it was a live recording, and that was really, really clever stuff.
I know what you mean, as you know, and this isn't a criticism, but there's some albums that feel like they're made in a vacuum, like they exist in and of their own. Whereas with this, it's like, yeah, those elements of the stage have been absolutely brought in, and you're right, it's not flat at all. It's completely got life within each and every track that you've got in there. It's really, really exceptional what he managed to do, and what you'll manage to do, I guess.
I mean, because I remember he'd just done Alphabetical Phoenix, which we loved that record. I think he'd just done that. Or maybe, but anyway, it was like the last record of the record before. And I remember being a bit nervous with him on that, because that album is so meticulous. And it's obviously, I mean, it sounds like, cause it's quite sort of, it feels like kind of almost like NERD or something. It's got a very like, everything's replaced with samples and everything. So I was a bit, and a lot, like you said, a lot of his records, but with us, like that's the genius. That's why he's a genius producer, because he just completely switched the gears of how to work with us. And that was to like really work for us. I don't think the other way would have worked. I think and it means that our music, you know, ended up finding this amazing space in like festivals and live, because it is, that record makes it it's like come on in, you know what I mean? It's got that vibe.
Yeah, it's a perfect bridge. You don't have to imagine it on stage.
But it's amazing now, being a bit older, and obviously, you know, me and Hugh both have over the years have gotten quite into production and stuff. And it's like just looking back, and like we were so young, and we could have been, you know, we didn't really know what we were doing. And I think it's really cool that we collided with Tony Hoffer at that time. I think, you know, he really set a path for us that we should be very, appreciative of.
Like, how do you give a band a sound that play within the same song three different genres? I mean, it's nuts. I mean, there was like ska and indie and pop all going on at once, and yeah, he managed to give us a sound. That's like, we owe him so much for that.
Awesome. Shout out to other producers out there that a lot of them don't get their dues. So, you know, it's great to, I mean, obviously Tony's Tony, but it's great to talk about production and records. We've got some questions from your fans on Twitter. So I'm just going to pick out what's going to be our first one. So our seller Amy says, what do the Kooks think, or what do you think, Luke, that the most underrated song on the album is? And she adds that she thinks they're all good, by the way.
That's really nice. On Inside In. Probably I Want You is one of my favorite songs on the album. It's hard to say underrated because, you know, but it's one we don't really play it live, and I don't hear people talk about it too much, but I think that's a really special moment on the record. And it was the vocals again, it's what I was talking about, the emo thing. It's like really like it actually made me feel quite emotional remembering how I felt at the time doing it. And it's a proper breakup song. It's just like full-on breakup, like tearing yourself apart. So that's the one that springs to mind, I would say.
It must be a strange
question.
Yeah, it's a great question. Thanks for selling, Amy. It must be, what was my train of thought, like just a strange sensation to know that maybe there's a song that you've poured your absolute heart and soul into, and it's a great song, and you know your fans, you know, really like it. And then there might be a song that you brilliantly wrote in 15 minutes, and that's one that like everyone like really like puts on a pedestal. You're like,
Oola,
is that really?
I love that song, but it is very quick. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Crazy.
No, it's funny. It's such a fun. It's a funny world. You know, this is it's. You can write a song that you think is the greatest thing you've ever written and no one gives a fuck. You just got to deal with that. And then, like you say, I mean, like Naive, you know, I think neither me or Hugh particularly rated it. Maybe you did, Hugh, I can't remember, but I certainly didn't think it was album worthy. And that is crazy, isn't it? Wow. And it's like, now that's the song that changed our lives, you know, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah, it's one of the biggest songs of the noughties. Like, it's funny.
Apparently it is, in a recent poll.
Okay. So we have Empire 03 from Brazil asks both of you, what is your own favourite song from the album and why?
Shout out to Brazil, definitely. Love, much love to Brazil.
Obrigado.
Can't wait to get back there. We would like to answer with the Royal We. I would say it's I've always really liked If Only, because it's just absolutely mental. Some of the chords were taken from like a funk song, Thinking of You, and it's just punchy and moving. Actually, it's really moving, like in an emotional way and a physical way. And I haven't ever tired of that song. You know, even in rehearsals, we rehearse. We sometimes over rehearse. It's rare that we over rehearse. We usually under rehearse.
What are you talking about? We over rehearse. Not letting you. That's so funny.
It depends on what like period you look at of our band. There's been like about 4 years in the middle where we would turn up to rehearsals, play one song, and then go to the park, and then come back, play another.
But I think it's because you would be like, guys, we're over rehearsing here, so come on, man, let's go for a drink.
Amazing. Let's check out another question. We have, let's see, Tricks for Caitlin would like to know if you guys would ever perform the album acoustically and live in any future tours. And she also adds that it has a very special place in her heart because it reminds her of the first time she fell in love. So big ups.
Wow, that's amazing. Well, hello. Yes, we would. Yeah, that would be really cool.
Right, that's going to make her very happy.
That was a really quick answer. Yeah, we would love to do that. Actually.
Yes.
I think it's a great idea, and we'll be playing it in a town near you soon.
Fabulous. Let's get your live agent on the phone.
But that'd be great. I mean,
do that, didn't we? I don't know if we need to go into detail, but we did. Well, we did do a tour.
Yeah, if she, I think, just saying, if you want to hear a version of the album acoustically, there is a live at Abbey Road that we did at the same time as the, like, when we released the first album that we did put out on vinyl. I'm sure it's out there. So if you want to hear it acoustically, it does exist. But it's a great idea. I mean, we should definitely do that when we can.
That'd be amazing. Cool. Yeah,
available to purchase as well later on.
Gotta get that in there.
There you go.
Perfect. I've got one more question for you guys before we wrap up, which is from Virgo Semvigor. I should have read that out loud first, but wow. There you go. I hope I've got that right. They say, if you were to release this album today, is there anything that you would change about it?
Wow, that's such a hard question to answer. I think that it raises something, though, to me, is that I just think that I would love to release this album now. I think that I wouldn't change the music, but I think that it would be really interesting. I think that like you were talking about the kind of pop and the way that things were at the time when we released Inside In, I think the climate would be quite good for us to release that album now. I think that's why it's doing quite, like, people like it now, because I think, so I would like to do that as an experiment. I don't know, you just can't say these things. It's a time capsule, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But yeah,
it's a 2006 thing.
It's a 2006 thing.
I definitely have something that I would change about it. There's just one thing. I remember when we were doing a kind of mix, like a desk mix in Curtain Road at Strong Rooms, and it was this. The song was like "Time Awaits," and we'd all been in the pub, and we were kind of bowled back into the studio, and it was just coming to the end, and Tony was like printing it. Doing a bounce of the desk mix, and I kind of went up to the master fader and I dipped it out really slowly, and then I dipped it back in again and then back out again, so there's like a double dip, and it was a joke, but for some reason
I love that though. That made the record, man.
Where can we hear that little double,
like, Pink
dip?
Floyd, isn't it?
It's on the album. It's on the album. Mm. It's just, I think my influence
is at the end.
Always, yeah, right at the end of Time Awaits, it dips out and then dips back in and then out again.
No, it's great.
It's on the record.
Amazing. Great. Well, I'm going to ask everybody to look out for that now, because with Classic Album Sundays, the tradition we have is that after we've spoken to our lovely guests, we always sort of just switch off our devices and listen to that album all the way through, uninterrupted, which actually feels very 2006 as opposed to 2021 in terms of distractions, but we're going to throw ourselves into immersing into the record. So do you guys have any recommendations or any ways that you would like to ask your fans to re-immerse themselves in this album now from start to finish? Maybe it's like a candle or a drink.
I think probably make yourself a White Russian, because I think those were on the go back in the day.
Have a White Russian and put on like a straw hat.
Strong.
Yeah.
We can do that.
Go in the garden. Snowy garden, maybe.
Let it out. Yeah. It's a wild record. It's meant to be enjoyed.
Perfect. Well, I'm going to Google what a White Russian is exactly and how I make it. And meanwhile, guys, thank you so much for doing this with us. It's been an absolute pleasure and a great nostalgia trip for me personally as well. So thank you. And really just massive.
Thank you so much.
The anniversary.
Yeah, cheers,
fantastic
team.
Record.
Nice one. Thanks for having us.
Cheers, guys.
All right.